The key word here is therefore. Therefore, he says, therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters. Therefore, it's the key word. And it's what links the mechanics of the gospel, again, what the gospel is and how the gospel works. What links that to the practical application of the gospel. You see, the gospel, it's not just about information. It's not just an information piece. It's about formation. It's about forming us. You see, the gospel has the power to form your life, to form my life. It has the power to transform you, to take you from where you're at, where we're all at, if you really believe the gospel. We're broken, we're sinful, we're selfish, we're self-focused. We look out, we care about our own skin, we look out for ourselves. You see, the gospel is able to take you from where we're at and remake us. Remake us in the image of Jesus Christ. And that right there, that is the whole point of the gospel. You see, this is a recovery deal. He wants to recover us, he wants to save us, and then he wants to recover, he wants to recreate us in the image of his Son. That's God's vision. That's God's vision for you. That's God's vision for me. So over the remaining days here, as we study Romans, we're going to be challenging each other to live the gospel out loud. To live it out. To live it out loud. We're going to urge each other to live out your dependence on the greatness and goodness of the Lord. We're going to urge each other to do that in a way that is not to offend others, but is to be out loud about it, to put it out there every day in front of everyone. So how do I do that? How do I live the gospel out loud? How do I live it out? How do I live out what we've been talking about? I want to share today three daily practices that are laid out here in Romans 12 that you can aspire to, that you can think about incorporating into your life. So we're going to look at three daily practices, and the first one is this, and if you want to follow along, if you go to the app, there's notes there, sermon notes, and they're right there if you'd like that. But the first one is this, it's continually remember the mercy of God. Continually remember the mercy of God. Well, what is mercy? Mercy is this. It's when somebody holds back what is deserved. It's when somebody holds back a judgment that is deserved. It's when the judge gives leniency. It's when the judge has every right, according to the law, to sentence an individual to a certain sentence, but gives leniency. That is mercy. It's when forgiveness is shown towards someone when it's in your power to punish them. That's mercy. That's holding back. Do you get it? That's holding back what is deserved. It's an amazing thing. It's an amazing thing. It's what separates us from the animal world. And look where it comes from. I'm going to put up a famous passage. It's from the 145th Psalm. Some of you are familiar with it. We sing a song that has this these verses in it. It's Psalm 145, 8 and 9. This is what it says. The Lord is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger and rich in love. The Lord is good to all. He has compassion on all he has made. So what we're looking at here is we're looking at continually remembering the mercy of God. Continually remember that he has shown us mercy. And again, that's back to the gospel. He's a holy God who is perfect and without sin and must hold us accountable, and yet he loves us, he is gracious to us, and he extends to us long-suffering and mercy. So here's the deal. When you and I understand the depth of our sin, when we wrestle with the depth of our sin and the equitable judgment of it, what is equitable for sinning, and couple with that the idea that we have not had to suffer the judgment, when you grapple with those things, you are beginning to be aware of the incredible mercy of God. You're beginning to get it. You're beginning to get that he holds back what you and I deserve. On the other hand, if you're living life and you're just kind of distant from your sins and from your brokenness, when you view sin in a way that's like, well, what's the big deal? Everybody does that. Or you rationalize your sin, well, because of this, I had to do that. Or when you compare yourself to others, well, at least I'm not as bad as, right? When you do that, you're not focusing on the mercy of God. And because of that, your appreciation for what God has done is little. It shrinks. And what Jesus said to the religious leaders 2,000 years ago applies. He says this, is in Luke chapter 7. We don't have time to jump into the context, but let me just give you the verse, and some of you will know specifically what he's talking about, but just reading it is helpful. Luke 7, 47, Jesus said, "Therefore I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven as her great love has shown. But whoever who has been forgiven little loves little." Have you been forgiven much? Are you aware of that? Are you thinking about that? What is your view of your sin? Is it easy to rationalize it away? But if we're going to live out the gospel, we've got to go back. We've got to continue to look at sin through God's perspective, how he sees it. And how does he see it? We've looked at this, we've studied this in Romans, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." We've got to go back there. We've got to continually go back there and remember the great things that God has done. How do you do that? How do you do that continually? How do you continually remember the mercies of God? Well, here's a couple of thoughts. One is this, one idea is in the area of solitude and silence. Time for reflection. Time to stop from what we're doing, you know, as we kiddingly say this a lot, step away from your phone, set it down. Somebody was telling me at their house when everybody comes home from school, you know, they get the box out and everybody puts their phone in the box and then they put their box away for a little while, you know, step away from the tasks, the things that you're doing. Maybe you put a, you have to use the phone for this, but you put a 5-minute timer or a 10-minute timer. You get on your knees, or you're just quiet. You're quiet with God. It's not like you have a list of things or anything like that. You're just quiet with the Lord. You reflect. You reflect on your life. You reflect on all the good things that you have in your life. Also, another is filling your mind with words that direct you to the greatness of God and the brokenness of man. Reflecting on words. You could do that through worship music that you play, or podcasts that you listen to, or scripture that you read and listen to. Continually remember the mercy of God in your life. I want to challenge you to do that. Let's move on to the next one here that's presented in regards to how can we live out loud? How can we live the gospel out loud? The second one is willingly present your body as a living sacrifice. Willingly present your body as a living sacrifice. Offer your body. offer your body. I'm using the word present is in an older translation of this particular passage. It's one I memorized a long time ago. And I think it best represents actually the original word. Present means to formally give. To formally commit to something. It's not just an emotional decision. It's a thought through, like, I am going to do this. And so you go through, you know, the formal way of doing that. It's a volitional act. It's something you've thought about and you've chosen to do. You willingly do it. And it says here, present your body as a living sacrifice. A living sacrifice, holy and pleasing, pleasing to God, holy and pleasing. A living sacrifice, what this points out is that this is not easy. It's not easy to live the gospel out loud. It's difficult. It demands sacrifice. It takes sacrifice. It's not easy, but ultimately rewarding. Sacrifice is the act of giving up something valuable for something viewed more important, more worthy. It's the act of giving up something that you value, you know, something that you care about. It could be time, money, reputation, giving it up for something else that you've gone through the thinking that this is more important, and so you willingly give it up. And this is what Jesus taught us to do. As he set aside heavenly position, and he came into our space, as it says in the book of the Gospel of John, he pitched his tent among us, and he suffered and he died. He became the ultimate sacrifice for our sins. Scripture says that greater love has no one than this, than he lay down his life for his friends. And this is what Jesus did for us. So it's a way that we follow Jesus, that we join Jesus by offering our bodies as a living sacrifice. It says, this is your true and proper worship. This is your true and proper worship. An older version says, your reasonable service. And I think what all this means is that it's logical. It makes sense. Like, Christ has done this for you, and therefore to make yourself a sacrifice, it's logical. It makes sense. It's like someone did this for you, and therefore it makes sense that I do the same thing, that I follow in that. It's fitting. It's a natural output of the input that we've received as followers of Christ, that we've received from Christ. It's fitting. It's like what we teach our kids. Like, when someone does something nice for you, what do you say to them? Somebody help me. Thank you. It's fitting, isn't it? It makes sense. We teach them to recognize what someone else has done for us, and we encourage them to verbalize it, to say it, to not just think it. So this sacrifice, it's passing forward to other people what has been given to us. And it's called worship here. Worship, and we talk about worship a lot here. We come here together today to do what? To worship God. What does that mean? To put him in the highest place. To elevate God above ourselves. To put him in that unique place. That he is ultimate, that his ways are ultimate, and that everything else is going to be under him. And so worship is a reordering of life around God. It's reordering your life. And so offer yourselves, present yourselves as living sacrifices. How do you do this? How do you do that? We'll be talking about this a lot in the next, number of weeks as we work through the rest of the book, because there's all kinds of subjects that come up. One is serve in the body, serve in the church, present your body as a living sacrifice. Discover what gifts that you have that can help the church be more effective in sharing the gospel, and serve in that area. Offer your body as a living sacrifice. So that's one that we'll be talking about. Others that are there, one, be hospitable. Be a lover of strangers. That's actually what the word means. It's philoxenon. Be a lover of strangers. Be hospitable to others. And I'm so glad that this afternoon our church, along with others in our community, are doing the fiesta lunch for migrant workers in our community, because we are lovers of strangers. Amen? Somebody showed us love when we were a stranger to God. And so we're going to pass that on, and that's the right way. Walking with others is another way that you can offer your body as a living sacrifice. What does that mean to walk with others? Well, it means to share the gospel with someone that may not know that the greatness of God. It's to take a risk and kind of share that in a loving way. It's walking with someone who's a new Christian. We just had 5 people baptized last week, and it's so cool. Praise God. And at Genesis, we have a lot of new followers, new believers that are needing mentorship, someone to come alongside, someone who's been a follower for a long time and can share and invest with them. These are just some ways that you can think about it. Let's move on to the last one, and it's this. Avoid conforming to the world and its ways and values, and allow God's word to transform your mind. So we're talking about living the gospel out there, and we're saying, number one, continually remember the mercy of God. We're going to do that in just in a minute. I'm going to have the band come up here real shortly. And we're going to remember God's mercy in our lives by celebrating in the meal. And then, we talked about the second one just a moment ago. We talked about willingly present your body as a sacrifice. Follow after Christ in being sacrificial, being others-focused and others-centered. And now this last one, we don't have a lot of time to talk about this, and there's a lot to be said, but what I want to throw this out there. It's avoid conforming to the world. Avoid conforming to the values of this world, the patterns in this world, and allow God's word to transform your mind. In other words, as followers of Christ, and I know not everyone here is a follower of Christ, and I just want to take a second and say, I'm so glad that you're here, and I'm not presuming this upon you. I hope that you come to trust Christ as your forgiver from sin and the leader of your life. That would just be a wonderful thing that would make my day, my month, if that happened to you. And just keep coming and just listening in and kind of seeing what the Christian life is all about. But for those of you that are followers of Christ, this is directed at you, and it is preachy what I'm saying here. I know it's a little preachy. Don't be molded by the world. Don't be molded by this world. Do not let your life be shaped by the values and the pursuits of this world. Instead, acknowledge brokenness. Acknowledge your brokenness. Acknowledge the brokenness of society and the need for the greatness of God. The need that we all have for the goodness of God. This world will pressure us and pressures followers of Jesus to assimilate with the culture. Let me just share 2 patterns of this in the world that are, these 2 patterns that I'm going to share are relentless at trying to conform Christians to be like the world. The first one is this. Biblical teaching on sexuality, biblical teachings on sexuality are obsolete, bigoted extremes and must be rejected. This is what the world is telling us over and over again, repeatedly, that we are bigots, that these are antiquated principles that God has given us, that God has given us out of his love for us as a society, as a world. And followers of Jesus must gently and lovingly point others to the truth that is revealed in Scripture. We must. It's a part of what it means to live out the gospel. Scripture teaches that sexual expression is designed by the Creator for the context and the covenant of marriage between a man and a woman. And part of living out the gospel is carefully, lovingly sharing that with others. It's one of the greatest expressions of love. It's to share truth, of course, in a loving way, in a kind way. Here's another pattern that is pushed upon us by the world as followers of Christ. An unborn child does not have the prerogative of personhood. If you've ever seen an ultrasound before, raise your hand if you've ever seen an ultrasound before, and you see that baby in the womb, you know it's not just a mass. You know that there is personhood in that little guy. I will never forget the day when our first born Jared was in the womb and I was talking to him like, here's Brenda's belly, and I was talking to him like, hey, how's it going in there, little guy, you know? And I was singing, and it's like, he's probably like, mute. We're reading and stuff, reading scripture, and all of a sudden, I got a little kick right in my mouth. Never forget that day. That's a person in there. Like, shut up! Please! And Scripture informs us that every person is made in the image of God. Every person is made in the image of God and therefore has value and should be treated with dignity and respect. How do you avoid conforming to the values of this world and allowing God's word to transform you? Well, my friends, first of all, yous that follow Christ, you've got to make a commitment to expose yourself to the teachings of the Bible. You have to make a commitment to be at the gathering, to hear what's being taught. You've got to make a commitment to a small group so that you can wrestle with the teachings of Christ and the teachings of the Bible with other followers. And you need personal time to grapple, personal study. Without it, without those, you will be weak and feeble, and it will not be a loud expression of the gospel. Your life won't represent it because the patterns of this world are going to be weighing on you and impacting you. The logical conclusion of accepting the gospel is living it out loud. That's the logical conclusion. That is the fitting conclusion. Continually remembering the mercy of God, willingly offering your body as a living sacrifice, and avoiding the patterns of this world, and allowing your mind to be transformed. It's our fitting response. It's our fitting response to all that Christ has done. And I want to encourage you to live it out. Let's pray as the band comes. Dear God, I thank you for your word, and I thank you that it directs us, it points us, it challenges us. It's not a spectator sport. Your gospel that you've given to us is not just for information, it's to form us so that we can become everything that you have in mind. And Lord, as we grapple with this, Lord, please let your Holy Spirit direct each one of us here, each one of us that follows you, to agree with you and to leverage our lives in a way that allows us to be that loud expression of the gospel. I pray all this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. At this time, we are going to celebrate the meal of remembrance. It's called communion in some churches, the Eucharist. We call it the meal of remembrance because it's a meal that helps us remember, just like we were talking about, continually remember. So I'm going to help you today to do that. We're going to do this together. It's a symbolic meal, and there's two elements. There's the bread. If you're looking up at the screen, there's the bread, and then there's the cup, and it's symbolic, and it helps us remember how God saved you and I. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verse 9 says this, "For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich." Amen. Wow, that's the gospel. So in just a moment, we're going to pass out the bread. And if you follow Christ and you are invited as it's passed out to take a piece of bread, and then we will all together in harmony and unity together, we will eat that. I'll direct at that point once it's all passed out. This bread, it represents the body of Christ. That Christ actually, he came into this world. He wasn't a ghost. It wasn't an aberration. The incarnation. And his body was broken for you and I. He was brutalized on the cross. He was flesh and blood here. He suffered in our place. And he died. He truly suffered. It wasn't some kind of minimal thing. And so in just a second here, I'm going to pray and give thanks. And I want to urge you to do something while the bread is being passed and the band will play instrumentally. I want to encourage you to do what 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 28 says. There will be kind of quietness at this point. And it says in 1 Corinthians 11, it says, "Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink of the cup." That we should examine our hearts. And what this is leading us to do is to confess any sins that we may have, any pride, or any lack of purity, to just confess that to God. And so during this time, I want to encourage you to really open up your life before God. So let me pray for the bread. Dear God, I thank you for coming into our space, for truly coming and living among us, for suffering on the cross, for enduring separation, and for dying and being buried. And Lord, as we, I thank you for the hands that prepared this bread for all of us to partake of. And I pray that, Lord, as we eat it, that you will bless it to us, dear God. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. Jesus took the bread and he broke it, he gave thanks for it, and then he said at that first meal, the Lord's Supper, he said, "This is my body broken for you. Please take it and eat it in remembrance of me." Let's do it. Dear Lord, thank you for the cup that reminds us of your blood that was shed, that it was poured out for the many. This cup, it represents the new covenant, a new way that you deal with us because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. We celebrate that. We thank you for that. Thank you for this cup that we will partake of. Thank you for the juice. Thank you for the hands that prepared it. Please bless it to our bodies. In Jesus Christ's name I pray. Amen. invite everyone to stand up right now, please. And together, everybody can stand. And together in unity, let's remember, Jesus said, this cup is a covenant in my blood. He said, take it and drink it in remembrance of me. Let's do that. Awesome. I want to encourage you to remain standing. We're going to sing this last song on our way out. And I want to encourage you, we're going to just kind of pass the cups down to the aisle. So just stack them if you could, and then they'll pick them up from that way.
So as we close this morning, I just encourage you, to me, reading this verse this week and hearing this message challenges me personally to kind of revisit submission and service to the Lord, and to look at what it looks like to worship the Lord outside of this and outside of music.